living in the host of the system. It's beneficial to the host. So all of us know about this. This is nothing very new about it. But what is of interest that we have to note is, in order to be labeled a probiotic, scientific evidence for health benefit should be documented. When we say scientific evidence, it's a little bit nebulous. This word is a bit nebulous. Even if you do a preclinical in vitro work, it's scientific. Right? You do a preclinical work, it is scientific. You do a simple observational study, it is scientific. You do a non-randomized study, it is scientific. So anything is scientific. So scientific is a very, very broad term. So the huge business of probiotics is going through under just using this one nebulous word, scientific evidence. So everybody creates some evidence, and we are all busy people, busy practitioners, and they come and tell us this is the scientific evidence, and we are sometimes compelled to go by that evidence. So what is the robustness of the scientific evidence, and what is the rational, and is there anybody? I was just looking at position statement from anybody. One country which has given a very clear position statement, NHS. NHS says this: discontinue. Stop. There is no rational in prescribing a probiotic. Clear. Period. The matter gets over. There is no scientific rational to say that probiotics work. That is, therefore, you can discontinue. The most widely studied probiotic that is available today is BSL-3. It's a brand name. I'm sorry, I don't want to mention the brand name, but here I have to, because that is not mentioned in any other name. So the only name available is BSL-3. The BSL-3 is supposed to be the most widely studied and published in GUT, the most prestigious journal, and including BSL-3, discontinue. It's a very clear statement. Probiotics are available for purchase by patients over the counter, but the patients should be told about the lack of clinical benefit. So if at all the patient says that I want to use it, the patient can go ahead and use it. We are duty bound to say two things. There is no great clinical evidence, number one. Number two, if there are any side effects due to your immunocompromised situations, you are responsible for it. But it's not a recommendation from any medical professional. This is the one statement I saw in NHS. I looked at USFDA statements. USFDA has not approved any probiotic as a drug. So very clear, they have said it is a food product and it is up to the patients. So there is no guideline as far as probiotics are concerned from the US FDA side. Indian FDA typically will follow that Western standard. So at the moment, there are no statements from the Indian counterpart. So actually, this sums up what I have to say, that we don't have any big rationale for, no big clinical evidence to prescribe here probiotic over and above our thigh salad. Curd rice is a super food. Right? If you take a curd rice or dahi, right, you are doing super duper good for your body. And I think that is the right thing that we are doing. And there is no need to prescribe this lactobacillus casei mixed with rhamnosus and this, that, and ask the patient to spend 50 rupees two times a day and 3,000 rupees patients spend sometimes. My friend is here, Vishwadana. 3,000 rupees they may not spend for an oncology, but for probiotic they'll spend. So we are rather doing that. So quickly, these are all the definitions. Probiotics are that the one that offers health benefits. There are terms used: prebiotic, that helps the growth of a probiotic, and symbiotic is a combination of probiotic and probiotic. Now these are all various statements. I just want to quickly, it's a bit of a philosophical statement, I just wanted to tell you. We have close to about, right, we have close to about 20 million baseband differences. Actually, it is about 0.6% is the difference between you and me, right, genetically. So, which is statistically insignificant. So, all of us present here are only different by 0.6%. So, actually, we are all one. Right? I mean,
Kodi Muhammadayal.
But actually, truth is that we are all one. So, statistically, we are insignificant. Microbes also have a bit of a diversity. So, net of it actually is that the net difference that we see is it that real our genetic makeup difference or is it a bit of bacteria and ourselves? So it's a little bit interesting. Now, this is the popular myth. The popular myth is, I have to come here because I also have to read some of them. It says that 10 to 100 trillion cells are there and 10 times more genetic material than ourselves in the human body. So I used to, when I was reading that, I was wondering if 10 times of us, of our genetic material is bacterial, then who is occupying whom? Are we, is bacteria living in us or are we living in the bacteria, within the bacteria? You know, or who, because 10 times is their majority, so we are not the majority. But these are all very nice and these are all published in various publications, TED Talks, etc., etc., etc. But what is the unfortunate is none of them are adequately proven. The truth is, this study has said that still we are outnumbered by bacteria by 1.3 times. So that is the final study. So it is not that we are outnumbered by 10 times, we are outnumbered by 1.3 times, 30 times, 30% more than what we are really. So that means still we are more bacteria than humans. So it's very difficult to accept, it hits you on the your ego, but then that's the fact, we are more bacteria than us. So these are all various types of bacteria, I mean probiotics. One thing all of us have practiced, all of us have agreed that antibiotic induced diarrhea we have seen. All of us have seen. And all of us used to give simple Sporlac, right sir, Dakshinamurthy sir? Simple Sporlac, patients used to be all right. So never was this kind of, you know, costly probiotics and things like that. We used to just prescribe one Sporlac, remember ampicillin and the kalthal evidho. After ampicillin, patient will come back with diarrhea. So it said, okay, over the phone or somewhere, we will take Sporlac from the kadakar. Moon matra samtona seriyadu. Probiotics, we'll come to that. We'll look at the rest. So, this is one area where Clostridium deficient, it's a major problem, Clostridium deficient associated diarrhea. And it sometimes are fatal. And therefore, there is a rationale to use probiotic. There are no big evidences to support, but rationale to use. So, it's more. There is a logic to use, but is it really good or not? That's something we'll see. So pulling these evidences together, there is one study which I saw that an antibiotic associated diarrhea, which goes with our experience, there is the probiotic groups, the incidence of diarrhea is only 8%, whereas in the control group is 19%. So suggesting that in antibiotic associated diarrhea, especially those antibiotics which are poorly absorbed in the gut, you could prescribe a probiotic. And that too, a simple lactobacillus is good enough, which is hardly 20 paise, right? So that is good enough. And these are all various studies which support in antibiotic associated diarrhea, randomized controls and observational studies. The biggest problem with the probiotics are many of them are observational studies. Probiotics is supported in, especially in NICU settings, in major, very severe, you know, necrotizing enterocolitis and late onset sepsis, such situations, there is a role for probiotics. Some randomized control studies say the quality of the studies are not good, but yet there are some evidence. So, the for and against quickly, This is the PowerPoint, preclinical and human data supports biological plausibility. But there is, this is not, none of the studies are approved by FDA. The quality of the studies are so bad that they are not approved. Second, numerous RCTs are conducted, randomized control studies involving 10,000 children, but product quality has been terribly bad, and there is no standardization, so these studies cannot be accepted as studies at all. Large magnitude of necrotizing enterocolitis in meta-analysis, but then still we don't have well-conducted multicentric clinical studies. So on and so forth. So, yeah, when you pool various studies, there are close to about 900 different studies on probiotics. And Cochrane review, all of us know, it's almost like it reviews once you have a sizable number of evidences. So there are 39 Cochrane reviews on probiotics. So when we analyzed that, there were only 23 were rejected because they didn't have adequate number of RCTs to include them as a good review. So when you take 16 reviews which are acceptable, and then 4 are in children, 5 in adults and children, and 2 in various other indications. Right? So just to quickly bring you on the evidence level, the evidence pyramid says always the randomized controlled study and meta-analysis on the top of evidences. And if you look at this 16 references that we give on the top of evidences. So these are all the various Cochrane reviews. In pediatric population, probiotic versus placebo, the quality of evidence is very moderate, and it says there is a benefit. But it is not high level quality of evidence. So the gradation of evidences are classified, and they say that there is no high quality evidence for probiotic at all. And whatever that we have is moderate. You can see it in children. You can see it in children receiving antibiotics. You can see it in adults and children receiving antibiotics. The evidence quality is either moderate or very low. This is with patients with ulcerative colitis, Searle's area. Ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease, low quality evidence, very low quality evidence, even not even eligible for assessment. So that is the quality of evidence. So these are not Cochrane. These are not individual studies, these are all Cochrane reviews. So each one has 20, 30, 44, 55 studies. So these have concluded that this is the level of evidence. Urinary tract infections, vulvovaginal candidiasis, and pregnant women, low, not assessed. Patients undergoing liver transplantation, very low. Pregnant women without metabolic or chronic disease, not accessible, very low. Patients with mechanical ventilation, very low to low, and patients with history of atopic dermatitis and allergic rhinitis and things like that, not even eligible for assessment. Between the species, is there any difference? Not much. Whatever that benefit you see, nothing, none of them are here, and some bacteria is here and things like that. They're all statistically completely irrelevant. So there is no big difference between one strain and another strain. So it is finally, what are we concluding? Conclusion is, are we justified? Yes, for antibiotic associated diarrhea, very especially for those antibiotics where there is no absorption or poor absorption, we are justified to prescribe. This is my take. This is not US FDA take. This is not Indian government take. This is not from UK. But I think there is some reason. We all have practically seen that when you give it along with severe diarrhea-causing antibiotics, it works. And simple Sporlac works. So there is a justification for that. There is some evidence for CDAD, that is Clostridium difficile. And because of the life-threatening situation, one can give a benefit of doubt by giving probiotic to these patients. So there is possibly, perhaps, a justification, not a very, very super-duper clean justification, but perhaps there is a justification. But be careful, let's do any of these lactobacillus, cheaper the better. There are few small, 1 minute I'll talk about the logistics. Quickly, probiotics are living organisms. They are stable, always below the 8 degree temperature. They are very good. If it is brought above 8 degrees and at 24 degrees, 90% of the probiotics die within few days, right? And in our country, where, you know, Rajasthan hits 52, 53, that temperature hits, and most of the retailers don't keep it in the refrigerator. So the probiotic that you prescribe, the patient spends 50 rupees, 100 rupees to buy. And then if the medicine is not taken out from the refrigerator, that means the probiotic is as good as powder. Nobody keeps in the refrigerator, then that probiotic is dead, actually. You are using cellulose powder there. So you are spending 50 rupees for cellulose powder, which we have to be very clear that if this product is not refrigerated all the time, even during transport, it's worth microcrystalline cellulose. That logistics we need to be aware. Overall rationale and relevance for this probiotic is extremely low. I don't want to put them extremely low, right? Low. Thank you very much.
Traditionally, we prescribe B-complex. Has it any role? Traditionally, we prescribe B-complex. Has it any role?
Sir, B-complex for replenishment, because of the intestinal flora getting lost and replenishing it, if you give it, I don't think you have any, you are not doing any harm to these kind of patients. Replenishment of intestinal flora, even if you don't do anything, it happens automatically. Because all the time our skin, our glabella, our nose, everywhere the probiotics will go quickly occupied. You don't have to replenish with the probiotic supplementation. Curd rice is good. I mean, honestly, curd rice is good. I'm not here to promote any religion or anything. Please understand, curd rice is good. Yogurt is good.
Just as an extension.
Yes, sir.
You all may be surprised that there is a concept called fecal transplant.
Yes.
And, you know, it is very useful for, I mean, it has come out in the published
journal. Gut also has published.
Fecal transplant therapy for necrotizing colitis, and etc. Yeah. And fecal oral capsules are also available. So that also might be an extension of this.
Yes, yes. The only thing, sir, only Dr. Krishnan, the reason I did not include it, right now it is still work in progress. Robust evidence has not yet come. But once it comes, I think you are right. The point is taken. It's being used. So,
about 24 degrees, the shelf life is not possible, you may say.
Yes.
But how about the alimentary system temperature?
Yeah, see, that is why when you give, that's why they say that quantity should be at least 5 billion. 5 billion CFU to 10 billion, 30 billion CFU they give. For one simple reason, that when you give 30 billion or 10 billion, we know that 75% will be killed in the gastric acidity itself,
yes,
and in the heat.
Yes.
Some of it will get killed in the bile. And so probably that what will reach to the lower intestine is about 5%.
Yes.
So
which is enough, perhaps.
Which is not enough. That is why, you know, you can see all these results.
That's why you need
to be not enough.
That's why you need fecal transplant.
No, he has a point. He has a very good point.
At par with Maharaj, even in
practice.
No, sir. That's what I said. No.
No.
Answer is clear, no.
Yogurt which is available in the market, is it a good, better than curd, or which is superior?
Sir, yogurt with slight pulipu, right? Now on the pulipu
layer. It's tastier, actually.
No, sir, the one that is little sour, yeah. The yogurt with little sourness, we generally think that it's a poor quality, but a little bit of sourness indicates that it is fermented. All the fermented foods are good, including padesa. So that is why we are coming back to all that. All fermented goods are good, but we can't promote beer in IMA.
Yogurt is available in the market, it's slightly sweetish. Yogurt which is available in the market is slightly sweetish.
Sweetish and
sugar. Sir, they add sugar, sir. They add sugar. They add sugar.